Coming from Cincinnati, this is the Spin Lob.
Welcome, everyone, to the Spin Lob. Here we are at Season 2, Episode 8. We have an aviation update. This one actually is a little bit closer to my heart because this is talking to two head coaches from the school they coach that I grew up at Sycamore High School. We have head coaches Rachel Perdue, formerly Rachel Rust, and Nicholas Hellwig, still Nicholas Hellwig. The Spin Lob is produced and recorded live by Mike Jones and Nick Hellwig. It's supported by the Ohio Squirrels Water Polo Club. You're never too old to get in the game. And also by Marlins Water Polo. For the love of the game, there is Marlins Water Polo. This podcast is all about Ohio water polo and how we fit in the national scene. It's a combination of what's going on in Ohio, the Midwest, and at the national level. Nick, you have a ton of updates around what's going on with water polo around the area and across the country. Why don't you jump in on that?
Yeah, we had a lot of water polo the past week, both on the college and the high school level. So let's do a quick rundown of the college scene. And actually, that was just basically from this weekend. A lot of water polo, and I tweeted out some links to the live streams. I mean, you could have watched Division One, Division Two, Division Three, combination of those. You could have been all over the place. The really cool thing is there's a website called the Fosh, F-O-S-H, and that really has all the updates. And I was talking with Coach Dave Matulis today about what that is. And basically, your assistant coach is on a computer instead of a normal pen and paper and is just typing in, you know, stats and updates and, you know, shot here, shot there, and teams are required to put those in. So it's an intense, like, rundown. So you can either, you know, if you can't watch the live stream or you didn't have that, you can actually watch some play-by-play, get some updates on all that. So the Fosh is kind of where to go if you want to see how things went. And that's kind of where I get a lot of the information from. And so this is where you can get, you know, the information about the number 8 Michigan game versus number 13. I mean, those two teams battle it out, I think, weekly, if not multi, you know, times each week. In the first game on Saturday, Michigan top number 13, Indiana. Michigan trailed the whole game going into the fourth and then just lit up the goal. They get a 5-1 goal differential in the fourth quarter to end up winning 13-11. Very physical game, it looked like. 22 different ejections combined for both teams. Oh. Some major scores. Number 23 for Michigan ended up having 4 goals in that game alone. So very physical in that Division One level. In other scores, we have Penn State Barron topped Utica 13-5 and 16-5. That one's, you know, another close team. It just right over the border in Pennsylvania. This is actually former coach Dave Matulis used to coach that program as well. And then kind of in a big upset, you know, this isn't too local, but LaSalle took down number 21 Bucknell in a high scoring game, 20-19. But then in the next game, Bucknell took it 11-9. These are all kind of the women's score. So you can kind of see that these are some pretty high scoring games. And then Gannon, which has, you know, I've had a couple local players play on that one. They lost to LaSalle 13-8 in their first game on Saturday. And then you have Mercyhurst, which we've had lots of players go through from Ohio. We had a slow start for both teams, a 0-0 first quarter. And then Mercyhurst just opened up the floodgates on that one, ended up winning 18-9 over Grove City. And number 10 for Mercyhurst had a fantastic offensive game, going 4-for-6 on her shooting. But in the other side of that, in the losing effort, Grove City's number 12 ended up having a 5-for-6 day. And that's really impressive. You know, kind of showing the high caliber shooting that we have in these games. And then our always favored Wittenberg kind of split their day. They defeated Grove City 20-11, but they really couldn't contain the Mercyhurst offense as they fell 5-17 on Saturday. So that was a just Saturday games, Mike. I mean, that's a lot of water polo to watch, a bunch of regional teams to keep an eye at. And so I can't wait till, you know, Coach Savon comes back and tells us all about her season in person at some squirrels practices.
Oh, yeah. Can't wait.
And then there's more games today. And of course, on our Division I level, it's Michigan versus Indiana again. And that's got to be exhausting for both teams. This time, Michigan won 10-3. And then at the Division II and III level, Gannon took on VMI, losing in a nail biter, 15-16, and then fell also to Villanova, 10-12. We have the NCAA Men's Championship kicking off this week, starting on March 18th for water polo as well. So we'll keep an eye on those games. So that's kind of our college rundown. And then I know what a lot of people are looking for is what is going on in high school water polo right now, especially as the season's starting to heat up. In high school water polo this past week, we had our first set of dual matches up in the North region. Upper Arlington boys took on New Albany. The JV squads tied 9-9, but the varsity team for the Golden Bears really clawed out a major victory, 19-0, against New Albany. And this really puts them continues to put them in first place with 2-0 in the region, and an overall record of 3-1. On the girls' side, Upper Arlington girls traveled over to Thomas Worthington, and Upper Arlington had a commanding victory, 15-6 on that, on Thomas's first home game of the season. With this, you know, being the only girls' game played across the state, UA is now in first place. And Thomas Worthington, I guess, de facto being in second place because they're the only teams that have played a regional ranking game.
Nick, has every boys team played a game so far? I think you have not played yet, Sycamore, but no. Has every other boys team played?
So I know on the boys side, let's see, I know Milford and St. X and Princeton have in the South region, us, Mason, and Walnut Hills have not. The Northern region, I know Thomas Worthington, Worthington Kilbourne, UA, St. Francis, and Napoleon have, but St. Charles in Sylvania have not, and New Albany had not as well up until Tuesday. So everybody will have their first game at least by midweek this week.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. St. Charles, you know, they're coming off of that championship run last year, really kind of owning their opponent. I think that I believe I was sitting watching. It was UA St. Charles in the finals, I think. Maybe it was.
Yes. No, you were. It was one of the best
games. And it was close. Yeah.
Yeah.
Back we'll see how St. Charles comes out without Jeff and Mara at the helm. So we'll see what goes on there.
Yeah. So new head coach Andrew Hoffman gets his first game this Wednesday, I believe, or Tuesday or Wednesday, against Worthington Kilbourne at Worthington Kilbourne. Sylvania is getting its first game at Napoleon this week. Sycamore and Walnut Hills are getting their first game on Tuesday at Sycamore. And then Mason will get its first game as it hosts Princeton. And then we have the Milford St. X rematch from this past weekend, or 2 weekends ago, I guess, on Tuesday. So, and on the girls' side of that, so, you know, so this is really most girls' teams are getting their first game this week and this weekend. So at least in the South, every team, I believe, will have their first dual match. In the North, not all of them, because not all of them have a dual match this week. But then the tournament this weekend is coming up, because we do have the UA boys are hosting a tournament and the Princeton girls are hosting a tournament. And so there's some big matchups coming this weekend. There's the UA Mavericks state rematch at 2 p.m. on Saturday. And then our guest today does not have an easy road either, as they take on both UA and Napoleon, two powerhouse teams as well. On the boys' side, there's some heavy matchups this weekend. St. X taking on UA in the first game up at UA. And this is really some of the last tournament UA is having before they move into their new pool for next year. And then we'll see a St. Charles UA matchup as well later on the last game of the day. I think we're on 6:50 on Saturday. So if those are streamed, that'd be great. I know Princeton, New Albany, and Napoleon are going up to that boys one. And then down here, the girls side, it is a packed Saturday of games. And so this kind of brings us up to our new segment, which we are doing the top plays of the week. So we will now introduce that. And see what our top plays are. We got two of them this week. These are submitted by teams themselves, and we will choose on them. And so the ones that we chose this week, one out of college. This comes from the Gannon VMI game, where local player Amanda Putoff was playing goal. In that tight-knit game, she made a huge steal just outside the two-meter, keeping the ball away from a probable goal and keeping her team within one goal to try to pull the lead. They unfortunately don't get to get the win on that one. And then our second one comes from the Thomas UA dual match this week, and it seems to be a goalie top play this week, as the Thomas goalie, after a really strong offensive play, leads to a UA 5-meter. And this is where Thomas Worthington's goalie, senior Izzy Thomas, made the, you know, our top list by saving the first 5-meter shot of the season. So a stellar block by Izzy Thomas from Thomas Worthington on that one. So those are our two top plays of the week. There'll be a lot more to choose from coming up with all these games, I am sure.
Yeah. I think goalies in general are going to pop up here a lot more often than we think, because I'm horrible at goalie, and I think that is just a next level kind of a position. You got to have leadership. You got to have thick skin. You got to be, you know, you're the last line of defense. So that's awesome that Amanda and Izzy are on here. Congratulations to both of them.
Yeah. So if you watch any games and you think that top play should be nominated or at least mentioned, let us know, and we can put that on our list of top plays of the week. And with that, let's talk some more water polo without me having to talk as much. Mike, if you want to go ahead and introduce our guest so that they can talk a little more than not just me.
But I got a question for you first, Nick. Do you just go around trying to find like cool sounds for this podcast all the time? Because you are not thin with cool ideas all the time. I commend you on the segment. It's awesome. I think it's going to grow. I think it's going to bring a lot of a little more pizzazz to this. So I agree with Nick. Send them in. Anyone you got, we will showcase as much as we can. In fact, we might do a podcast just talking about top plays. How about that?
I spend way too much time looking at just things that just make things more fun and then probably don't need time to look at that.
Yeah. All right, here we go. So we have Miss Rachel. Now, Rachel, first of all, welcome. We're really happy that you could be on here. Is it pronounced Perdue, like the college in Indiana?
Yes. Spelled like the chicken, though. Or I guess
also the chicken. There you go. Spelled like the chicken. So thank you for being on the show. We appreciate it. First, we want to, as we do with many guests that many people may not know, give us a little background on yourself, you know, growing up playing the game, where you went to high school, college, because I think you bounced around to a couple colleges, but you can tell us that, playing water polo. So yeah, any kind of background you'd love to give us, that'd be great.
So I started out my water polo career at Princeton High School. My brother actually got me interested. He started playing his sophomore year. And when I became a freshman, he was like, just do it, just try it. And so I was like, okay, I'll try it. And I fell in love. So I played there for 4 years. And then I went to a school in Cleveland called Notre Dame College for my first 2 years. And I kind of foresaw the team fizzling out, so I transferred, which they 2 years after, or yeah, 1 year after, I ended up not having a team, unfortunately. So I transferred to a school called Lindenwood University near St. Louis, Missouri, and I played there for 2 years. I was lucky enough to be able to play with my sister as well, so when I went in as a junior, she came in as a freshman, so we got to play together again. And then I came back home and found out Princeton was looking for a coach. So I decided to start coaching again, because I love the sport so much. I wanted it to keep on keeping on. And then I coached there for 2 years and found out three different schools, high schools in the area, were looking for coaches. So since I knew Princeton had a coach, I looked at Sycamore because it was closest to me. And I've been there since.
Lending one, that's interesting. You know, growing up in St. Louis, you know, I used to drive by the Lindenwurm University sign all the time and never in the world thought, you know, Lindenwood water polo powerhouse. But it has turned into a hotbed of water polo in St. Louis, and something that, you know, when I was growing up and maybe I was just there a little too, wasn't on the radar of stuff. And just seeing that on both girls and guys side, how much that has just exploded at that university is interesting. You know, can you give us like kind of a what it was like there?
I loved going there. It was a great opportunity to meet a bunch of new people. They have a lot of international students that come there, so I got to meet people from all around the world. Their guys team kind of recruited people they knew, so their team was a little more international than ours, but it was just great seeing people from all over come there for school.
Yeah, that's always traditionally been a very good program, especially on the men's side. I remember a kid from UA went there for 4 years, and that's blanking me, but he ended up being a starter on that team. I think he won a couple club national championships. I used to ref with the guy that used to be down there. Unfortunately, he passed away. I'm forgetting his name as well. Greenhouse. I did a couple games with him at a club tournament. Nice guy. But yeah, it's a small little development program for, I mean, it's a great college club program. I'm surprised they never went division, you know, three or something like that. But I guess other things kind of got in the way. I remember they did go to a couple of tournaments on the East Coast that were Division I tournaments. I think they went to Navy a couple of times and things like that, and they held their own. So it's pretty awesome. So let's get into coaching. So Nick, we'll start with you. How's this coaching in the pandemic been going? Any kind of insights on lessons learned, best practices, what not to do?
I mean, it's definitely different. I mean, the move to spring is different in itself, and I'm sure we'll talk about that in a little bit, but the pandemic stuff is so different because it's not the same in every school. So for a state sanctioned sport, like OSHA comes down as every school has to be doing X, Y, and Z. Whereas because we're not state sanctioned, it really comes down to what can go on in your county from Board of Health. And then even that changes from school to school. For instance, at Sycamore, since our school, the pool and facility is so small, we can't have any fans. Whereas, you know, Princeton can. Our school players and coaches that are not in the pool have to wear a mask before they get in. And I was talking with the Worthington Kilbourne coach, and same thing for them. But then at other schools, it may not be as strict. And so really kind of navigating what is going on in different schools. And so as a coach, you've got to kind of be really aware of what's going on, how that can work. And so when you're hosting teams, you've got to be really prepared and sending out information. I was just talking with the Walnut Hills coach today about, hey, don't forget to remind your kids they have to have a mask. You know, we'll send out reminders on where they're coming in, how they can set their stuff up, you know, locker room access. It's like where we don't have locker room access for visiting teams. And so you have to be very prepared. And the other thing is kind of keeping in mind what's going on with players and parents. You know, they want a season so bad, and things are different. And so looking at how that's going to work, I know, Rachel's kind of run up with this, me is like, we were very limited on what we can and cannot go to. And so a lot of stuff is behind the scenes that the players don't know, that, you know, we're fighting for game times, but at the same time, like, we're constricted on what coaches can do, and just workouts. Right. And Rachel, your team is huge, right? I think added a third of more players than normal. And so trying to figure out what you can do. I know on the boys side, we can only have 10 boys in the locker room. So we have shifts of like group A cleans up on this day, group B changes. And then the next day it's group B cleans up and group A goes changes. What what advice do you have, Rachel, on some of that? How have you made some changes?
So I had to split my team kind of in half, and instead of us all being in the pool at the same time, one, because I have 27 girls, which the very first day was overwhelming because, you know, people sign up and you don't expect them all to come, because it's happened in the past where they'll sign up and just not show. So I was not expecting everyone to show up, but I ended up having 27 girls. So I had to reevaluate how I did my pool time. So now I have half doing dry land while the other half is in the water. So that's a little new to me, trying to figure out who goes where. And definitely,
I would say being more flexible this season, like, it depends. Like, you know, we've got spring break coming up next week, and right now I have no idea how many players are coming to my practices on Monday. And so I think as a coach, you've got to be very flexible, and we're still early in the season. And so that, you know, a team getting shut down could happen. So are you going to have to adjust, you know, your game schedules? How's that going to work? If your team gets shut down, what are you going to do for that 2 weeks? You know, is it, you know, Zoom conferences can do that. The same time, that's 2 weeks out. So how, you know, figuring out how you're going to rearrange that. And then simple things like trying to figure out what to do for a senior night. You know, I've been talking with our swim teams about, you know, how did you guys do it? And, you know, they ran a, you know, a senior kind of just ceremony on a different night. And so working with parents, and this is where you've really got to lean on parents for help on this, because trying to cover this all by yourself, doing it all on your own, you know, using your assistant coaches, using family members, and just being creative this season is really what's going to be about. Because in the end, it's, you know, the kids are there to play water polo. And so what can you do to help them play? And anything else you've done, Rachel, with the team? I know you pulled in your sister to help out. What'd you do with that one?
She provided dry land workouts for us because she's a physical therapist, and because of that she was worried that they might not be doing the workouts correctly. So she wanted to come in and kind of make sure that everyone understood what form they should be doing for each workout. So that was more of a to help prevent injury. She came in to help explain how each workout was supposed to look like.
Yeah, I was jealous. I was like, oh, that's brilliant. You know, because we've done dry land workouts, but, you know, having someone to make sure that each exercise is doing correctly, especially if, you know, we can get an idea, but at times you may not know.
Right. And I've seen when I went out there with them, they like start doing something, because I even provided them with pictures and they were doing it wrong. So I was like, no, it has to go this way. And she was like, I'll come in and show them how that they're actually supposed to be doing it.
Rachel, if you need someone to increase cardio, have them meet me at like 4:30 on a Saturday morning and we'll go on a long run. They might get lost out there, but we'll go on a run. They'll be back by 7:30 or something like that.
Oh yeah, I'm
that's
sure
the only support that I could give you.
7:30 p.m. if they're getting lost or run like I do. There might be stops right every stop sign.
Yeah, as there should be. All right. So, you know, some craziness going on, and, you know, you guys seem like you're trying to keep up pretty well. You at least have a partner in crime here, each other, to kind of go through this and get through all the navigation. But any positives coming out of this kind of pandemic on what you plan on continuing to do? So an example is, I talked to a couple other coaches, Zoom calls. They plan on using Zoom going forward as a way to connect with the team all together while they're at home. We don't have to be in the pool area, but doing a once a week Monday night Zoom call after practice just to connect on some things or review game film. Anything else you guys are thinking about doing? Nick, we can start with you.
Sure. We added two things this year, which I think have been awesome. And they've been actually open to both the girls and the guys team. One of the things we added was just starting back maybe beginning of February, we just had a 45 minute just Google Meet call with any player to just walk through different parts of the game, especially for players that are new coming in. I mean, you got to remember that back in when we play in the fall, you have pretty much all of August to walk through how to play the game. Whereas if you are doing, you know, spring, you've got like 2 weeks before your first game and sometimes 1 week. So we were just walking through, you know, here's what things are. Here's things we forget to tell you. Like, you have to clip your nails. You know, what suit do you like? Just the basics, and then walking through each week. Okay, here's what some of the rules are. And I think even my returning players were on and asking questions like, oh, I thought we could do this. And so I think that was great coming into it, just, you know, Monday night for 30 minutes. And the second thing we added was we use cage cap to really work with our goalies. I'm not a goalie. Rachel, you're not a goalie. But Tom Ray out of St. Louis, we've had hosted a couple camps out here with him, but he is working with our goalies every Monday night for about a half an hour and just going through basics. Even for returning players, it's just like making sure they're fundamentally sound. And it's going to be each week he's building on it. And this is a chance to get a coach that's not even on our state to help out. Rachel, anything you guys have been doing?
I've been fortunate enough to have you schedule some of that stuff. I haven't really planned anything outside of that. We do have, it's not really Zoom call, but on Mondays we've blocked off a room so we can spread out and watch video. So that's the thing that, because sometimes it's easier for them to see it than if I'm trying to explain it to them.
Yeah. Well, and I think it's going to help out this year with the games being live streamed, that there will be so much more video.
So oh, yeah. I'm very excited about that.
All right, so big news coming. Well, we heard it already. Sycamore is getting a new pool. Congratulations. Rachel, we'll start with you. What are your it's huge news, of course. Do you know anything about the pool that's coming, first of all? I think we have a little bit of information, but do you know anything about it? And then how is that going to help Cincinnati, Ohio water polo and swimming and other sports that use the pool?
I know a little bit about it from what Nick's told me, so he probably has more details. But I am really excited for that as well, especially with me having 27 girls. Two more lanes would definitely help out with spacing, so that's going to be super nice. I think that with more space, that maybe it might give us more opportunity for hosting a tournament. We have had tournaments there in the past, but I think it will just be more exciting. And
yeah, I mean, an all deep pool for sure,
right,
is better than a shallow deep pool. Yeah, we all know that. Although I remember reffing some of the Sycamore Invitational, the McLennan, or I forget the name of it, used to be back in the day, and they're competitive for sure. But you're right, an all deep pool just makes it look so much more competitive and enticing for teams to travel to, probably too. What do you think with this new pool, good or bad?
I think it's only gonna be a positive. I mean, you can't thank the Seeger family enough for their donation on making this better. I know they have been so active in trying to get things better for the swimming and water polo programs at Sycamore and the diving programs as well. I'm in building, so I get a little more information than Rachel can. You know, I in my talk with the principal one day, he just like, hey, have you seen the new schematics for the pool? I was like, no, not yet. And he just pulls those up. So I get a little more inside information, and then I kind of make sure that Rachel knows. But I mean, like you said, hosting not just tournaments, but I mean, that opens us up to being able to host regionals or states. You know, we're just seeing just a little smaller than maybe Princeton, but you know, a new facility on that with, you know, the bells and whistles and you know, just is gonna be there, which is fantastic. And then actually with all these live streaming things, it's that stuff now being built in. So I think that's huge. And then it opens up to bigger swim meets because you have the stands there, you know, and all sorts of things. I mean, it now allows for Cincinnati right now to have Mason, Sycamore, Princeton, as Aldi facilities. I know St. X is getting a redone, and it's mostly Aldi. So I mean, that's a big advantage for Cincinnati water polo in general to have these types of facilities to move forward. So I think that's going to be pretty big on this one.
Yeah. Was it 20 years ago? I was graduating high school, and St. X did not have a water polo team. So we never went there obviously to play, but every pool was shallow deep, every pool in Cincinnati. And it's great to see what it's come. It took a while. I think Sycamore has been due. Mason didn't even have a pool back in the day. So all things are going in the right direction. Let's keep this going. I think everyone's going to get a little benefit from this, even if you're a nearby school. I think you're going to get some kind of benefit from this new pool and all these upgrades around the city. And it also might, you know, put a little nudge behind like a school like Loveland, who doesn't even have a pool, to maybe say we should probably get a pool and invest, because it's going to attract students, it's going to attract talent, it's going to build yourself as a caliber program. It's expensive, but I think having a pool at your high school is a big deal. So we talked a little bit about moving from the fall to the spring and its impact to your numbers, Rachel. It's increased your numbers to 27, which is great. What are your thoughts just in general on having the season in the spring versus the fall?
For me, I didn't really think about how much it would change until we started like doing our first coaches meeting about how, one, we have spring break built in there. So that's a challenge for some of those athletes that are going out of town for spring break. And then we also had to schedule our regional and state tournament, think about people's graduation weekends. So that was kind of affected how long and short our season might be.
What
about you?
And that was pretty, is tough and something that all spring sports do. And then we also lose some of the outdoor tournaments, which is sad, like Ohio Cup, you know, obviously can't do an outdoor tournament. And so no plans now, can't really do ever again, the sunlight shootout, just because the pools aren't filled and stuff like that. I think another thing, which was kind of a drawback on my side, is we lost players to baseball, lacrosse. I know, Rachel, you lost some players to lacrosse too. Lacrosse and softball. And then some kids that are focusing just on club swimming, that in the fall, you know, is more of a, there's a bigger break than there is in the spring. And so we lose some kids to that. But on the plus side, we're not dealing with August practices where families are on spring break or didn't know when practices start. You can recruit, you know, in building, in season, which is maybe a little easier. Those kids see the kids every day and you can pull them in. Coming right off a swim season, that is a huge benefit with, you know, players being, you know, very much in shape already, which I think is helps out a lot. But it's a very shotgun start. Like, you're got to be ready to go pretty quickly. So, you know, it's really, I think for me, it's too early to tell if I like this or I don't. I'm not gonna lie, I liked having the falls off, but at the same time, you know, we'll see which one's going to turn out to be better by the end of the season.
Yeah, I think you kind of said one of the benefits, Nick, about recruiting well in academic season. So you could actually do a fall ball where you have one or two practices throughout the fall. So, you know, just trying to mix things up, invite those players in, start recruiting then in the fall. So after swim season, those kids are ready to go. You've kind of connected with them throughout the year before even your season started versus the fall. It's tough because all summer, yeah, hopefully some of them played for Marlins or another club team and they're getting ready. But you don't really have that connection like you do within the high school. So I see lots of pros, lots of cons. So we'll see how this pans out and we'll see if it stays in the spring. I'm not sure. So,
yeah, I think we have a vote coming up in April if we're going to move it one way.
So it's going to be a great vote. You could just have it both seasons, fall and spring, period. Have two seasons,
I foresee a lot of coaches and their significant others putting the kibosh on that one.
Yes. Huge kibosh. Yes. All right. So quick question for you, Rachel. So let's talk about this fundraiser. So I know you guys recently had a fundraiser at MPH Brewing a couple weeks ago. How'd that go? And what's the fundraiser you got coming up on the 30th?
So a couple weeks, like last week was the guys one, just kind of a good kickoff to the season. It's a new establishment kind of in our district, and was eating dinner there one night and just happened to start talking up with the owner, and he was like, hey, you know, we really like helping out Sycamore High School. You know, we want to be a big part of the community. And so set that up, and, you know, it was, you know, any order, online order, to go order was all part of that, which I think was awesome, because, you know, especially now when it's hard to think about people wanting to donate money or other fundraisers that they're just not time to do, or they can do because they were struggling through COVID, that this restaurant, relatively new, was like, hey, we want you to have one here, come do that. And then Rachel, you guys have one on the 30th, correct?
Yes. So their assistant manager reached out to me saying how the guys had scheduled one, and I think she said a few other Sycamore teams. She's like, would you be interested in hosting one? And I was like, yeah, for sure. And especially with them being local, it was great opportunity, and I was really excited that she reached out.
Yeah, I'm gonna plug, the meal I had was awesome. It was a I don't even know what it was, but it was what it's called, but it was a bratwurst on a pretzel bun with like German potato salad and sauerkraut. And it was, I think I ate that in like 3 seconds and really got thought about ordering like one or two more for me, which probably would not have ended well, but I wanted to. It was so delicious. And I know they have
great fantastic
pizza. So yeah, I mean, even if it's not a fundraiser, you should go there and eat. It's really good food.
Yeah,
maybe
MPH, they're not a sponsor of the podcast. Yeah, so we'll see.
Last week was Uncle John's pancakes. This week is the food from MPH.
Yeah, just the food. I don't even care about anything else there. So good stuff. Last question for you, Rachel. So from what I understand, you got married last year during the pandemic. Real quick, how'd that go? Congratulations, and how is the special man Jamie doing?
Would not recommend trying to plan a wedding during pandemic, but we fortunately the guidelines changed in June, so we were able to have more people than just the 10 that they tried to tell us. It was just very stressful trying to figure out, you know, everything changing one day after the next. Not knowing what was going to happen was rough, but we made it there. We were able to have most of our guests. Some people decided not to come, which we understood. You know, it was up to them. Our ceremony was outside, so there were a few people that just came to the ceremony and stood off to the side. That way they could keep more further distance themselves. And then when we went in for the reception, the tables were set up with the same regulations as restaurants had to have, the like certain spaces between, only so many people at a table. And then when we got up to get our food, we were all wearing masks. Our caterers served, put the food on the plate for us. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it was definitely an experience. My mom made masks with iron-ons saying RNJ for all of the guests. Bless her heart.
Cool.
Now, I did see you guys got to play real water polo on your honeymoon. And I know, Mike, you said last question, but it made me think of this. So I think it's my new favorite one that I commented on, even on social media, was you guys on horses in the ocean or something like that.
Yes.
And so I was like, this is like literally what people think we do when we play this sport, right?
So I'd never heard of that before, but I kind of just told Jamie, my husband. I was like, I just, the one thing I want to do on our honeymoon is go horseback riding. Like, I love horses. I think they're so fun. And when we were looking at places, we saw swimming horses. So I was like, yes, we have to do it. And it was totally worth it.
If only you had a water polo ball. Only had a water.
Yeah. That would have been viral. Big time. Well, I've had a pleasure of meeting Jamie a couple of times. He's a great guy. And I hope everything's going, you know, well with all this stuff. You know, it cannot be easy getting married in a pandemic and, you know, having a honeymoon. But you got each other, and that's all that matters. So I'm really happy you guys were able to do that. A couple of my friends actually got married during this time. And a couple of my friends have had babies during this time, too. So all these monumental moments happen. And you just got to keep plugging along, being safe, and being, like you said, respectful of people that cannot attend because they just don't want to because of the pandemic. But that's awesome that you were able to do that, and I'm happy for both of you guys.
So Rachel, last thing before you go, any big players to watch this season as you guys kick it off on Tuesday and then at Princeton over the weekend?
We have Sophie Campbell, our goalie. She started her sophomore year and has been playing great ever since. She in the past few weeks of our first practices, she's been picking it up just like she never stopped. So that's pretty awesome. Ryan Carmody's definitely been one of our top players. She was one of our top players last year, and as well as Hannah Horn. She's been playing, and she started playing, I think, before she came into high school. So that was a huge help for her.
Yeah, on the guy side, we have a good core group this year. I mean, we are smaller than normal, but these guys are really looking to gear up. We have a great addition with a senior, Liam Skinner, former soccer player and super fast, one of the state qualifiers for Sycamore swimming added on. But then we have, you know, our captains, Jonah and Peter. Those two are hungry for water polo, along with we have, you know, Ben Freiberg in there. We have, you know, Scott Brown, Ethan Gauze, all these seniors and juniors really want to go. And we have some other younger kids looking to step up, like Adrian Banky. And so we're going to be small numbers this year, but man, they want to play.
Very nice. All right, Rachel. Well, thank you for your time today. We appreciate it. Nick, same to you, even though I'll probably talk to you next Sunday. appreciate everything you've given us and everything you've done for the sport. It's awesome. Your story is great. Keep telling it. If people don't know about you, tell them, you know, where you played for Princeton, you played for Notre Dame, you played for Lindenwood. You're on a break from the squirrels. We understand. We miss you. Come back whenever you can. And you are coach. You've coached around the block a little bit, and you're coaching a great program at Sycamore. And that is not biased because I went to Sycamore. I know you do a good job there. People like referees I've spoke to like reffing your games because you work with them and you communicate well, as opposed to Nick. So thank you for coming on board.
Thanks for having me.
Alrighty, so as we are removing Rachel from the call, we're going to go ahead and, is it okay if we close it up, Nick?
Yeah, it sounds good to me.
Good. I will plug one more thing, though. You know, again, the top plays is a new segment we have on the Spin Lob, thanks to Nick's creativity. If you have any top plays, Nick, where is the best way to send them to you?
Shoot, you could do it Twitter. You know, Cincy Water Polo, or you can do Instagram, or you can do it on our email as well, which is, you know, cincywaterpolo@gmail.com. Send us that. Let us know what it is. You know, see me on the pool deck if you see us coaching and say, hey, you know, this is a great one, and I'll jot that stuff. As long as I'm not in the middle of a game, don't do that. But any other time, you can always, or if you're doing against me, I might, but we'll.
The best one will be they do the play and then they turn to you and say, was that good enough for you?
Yeah. I don't know if I will laugh or be so angry when that happens, but someone's going to do it. It's probably going to be Johan Pereira's kid's going to do that. I have a feeling.
Yeah, good family there. All right. Very good. I'm going to close it up with our final remarks. So the Spin Lob is produced and recorded live by Mike Jones and Nick Hellwig. It's supported by the Ohio Squirrels Water Polo Club. You're never too old to get in the game. Go nuts. And also by Marlins Water Polo. For the love of the game, there's Marlins Water Polo. And our theme music is produced by Jason Shaw at audioandaudix.com. See you next time on the Spin Lob.